Winning across global markets. How Nokia creates strategic advantage in a fast-changing world. Written by Dan Steinbock. Narrated by John Allen Nelson. Publisher's note. This book will periodically reference figures. To view these materials, refer to the PDF companion to this audiobook. Introduction. Our industry is undergoing one of the biggest transformations in its history, which has been accelerated by the economic crisis, reported Nokia's CEO Olli-Pekka Kalasvuo in early fall 2009. The internet, PCs, and mobile communications were converging faster than had been anticipated. At the same time, consumers were no longer interested in just mobile devices, but also in solutions. There is no turning back, Kalasvuo warned. Winning Across Global Markets is the first book to tell the story of how Nokia prepared for this great transformation. It is the first book on Nokia's strategy, organization, and values that is based on interviews with all of Nokia's leading senior executives in the past two decades. No other independent author has gained such privileged access. The book tells the story of how Nokia creates strategic advantage in a fast-changing world, with the goal of showing how companies operating in technology-intensive or marketing-intensive industries, or both, can compete in order to win in a global marketplace. A brief history of Nokia's and Finland's challenges. In the 1990s, Nokia's senior executives found themselves ahead of both the United States and Japan in the mobile communications industry. The Finnish company seemed to emerge from nowhere as an industry leader. Newsweek once called it an overnight success. The reality, however, is more complex. Nokia's worldwide clout is barely a decade old, but the company itself was created almost 150 years ago in 1865. Nokia was founded during the early industrialization of Finland, a small Nordic country that has been ruled for centuries by its neighbors, Sweden and Russia. Over the past century and a half, Nokia has been created, recreated, and restructured again and again. It was born amid Finland's national awakening and has endured Russian oppression, a struggle for independence, the Bolshevik Revolution in Russia, a devastating civil war, the rise of nationalism and protectionism in Europe, a worldwide depression, two wars against the Soviet Union and one against Germany, devastation and heavy reparations to Moscow, the loss of eastern territories and integration of more than 400,000 refugees, post-war reconstruction, the Cold War and insulation from the West, national industrialization, decades of rapid growth, years of leftist radicalism, cyclical recessions. Moscow's perestroika, reforms, and glasnost, openness, the suicide of its charismatic executive and the death of his right-hand man, the collapse of the Soviet Union and the Finnish Soviet trade, Finland's most severe recession since the 1930s, participation in the European integration and monetary union, rejuvenation of growth and Nokia's boom years, the stagnation of the technology sector, outsourcing and offshoring, the rise of China and India, and most recently, the global economic recession. During these upheavals, Nokia has persevered and often led the country, overcoming one adversity after another and demonstrating remarkable resilience. Its global success, however, is the result of developments during the past two decades or so. Under the leadership of the legendary CEO Kari Kaarimo, Nokia grew very fast and ambitiously already in the 1970s and 1980s. It initiated the transformation from the old industries of forestry, rubber, and cable and moved toward electronics. In the process, it began to seek growth in non-traditional areas and grew into a diversified technology conglomerate. It had great aspirations, but lacked adequate capabilities. Betting on the future. In 1992, Nokia bet its future on a vision of digital mobile communications, under the leadership of its then-new CEO Jorma Ollila and the CFO Olli-Pekka Kalasvuo, who became the company's CEO after Ollila retired in 2006. Along with the extraordinary group executive team, Nokia's leaders focused the company on mobile communications and divested all non-core properties. Unlike most of its rivals, Nokia was not content with the notion that the cell phone would remain just an executive tool or a yuppie toy. It believed that mobile devices should belong to everybody, not just those living in advanced economies, but also to those in emerging economies and in the least developed countries as well. Amid this massive transformation, Nokia helped transform the way people live, work, and play in every corner of the world. The numbers tell the story. At the beginning of the 1990s, there were only 17 million mobile subscribers in the world. In 2008, this figure exceeded 4 billion users. By 2013, it is projected to hit 5.9 billion, driven by China, India, and Africa. In 2001, there were 42 million mobile internet users worldwide. In 2008, more than 400 million. By 2013, it is projected to exceed 700 million. 2009 saw a total of 1.2 billion mobile devices shipped. Shipments of these devices will nearly double in 2014 to a total of 2.25 billion. At the same time, application downloads are expected to reach 5 billion from 2.3 billion in 2009. As the world's largest device maker and with a market share of almost 40%, Nokia can take much of the credit for this enormous growth. Staying close to the productivity frontier. The communications transformation is not over. It is now entering a new stage. Technologically, mobile devices are turning into converged mobile devices. Traditional cell phones are gaining greater intelligence and turning into smartphones. Computers are growing smaller and gaining mobile communication capabilities. At the same time, both are converging and colliding. Geographically, communications used to be driven by advanced economies in the West. In the future, communications will be increasingly driven by large emerging economies in the East. More than any other company in the world, Nokia has seized these technological and geographic opportunities. Unlike many of its rivals, Nokia is not known for complacency. When one source of growth has been exhausted, it has moved to another through competitiveness, innovation, and perseverance. During the past two decades, value has migrated from mobile infrastructure to devices. Now it is moving to software and services, especially solutions, shorthand for mobile devices plus services. In each case, Nokia has been close to the frontier in productivity. Through years of hope and glory, doom and gloom, it has stood the test of time and, unlike most of its rivals, has been unafraid to embrace change. What happened to us was that we were not expected to succeed. That's our story, says Jorma Ollila, Nokia's chief executive from 1992 to 2006, and currently chairman of Shell. This is too personal, he adds quietly. But the most important cultural element that I've helped to develop in this company is that you can come back. It takes a lot of effort, sleepless nights, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, but you can come back. The question is, how? How has Nokia achieved its success? How does Nokia create strategic advantage in a fast-changing world? How has it been able to win across increasingly global markets? How does it innovate? What are its other strategic capabilities? How does it develop strategic advantage? How does it create and execute strategy? How does its organizational structure support and contribute to that strategy? What kind of values, culture, and people make that organization possible? Is Nokia's triumph sustainable? And what are its lessons to other companies operating in fast-changing environments across the world in both advanced and emerging economies? This book addresses all these questions. Underestimating Nokia's strengths. Nokia is history. Excuse me? It's a nice story, underdog and all that, but let's be real. It's DOA, dead on arrival. Why would you think that way? Microsoft will kill Nokia. The interviewer was a senior journalist at one of America's greatest business weeklies in an interview with the author that took place in June 2001. Like Bill Gates at that time, this interviewer thought that Nokia was in the business of manufacturing boxes, whereas Microsoft dominated software and operating systems. Since the value in the business was moving toward software and services, Microsoft would win and Nokia would lose. At least, that's how the argument went. Like Gates, the journalist thought that Nokia would happily go to its grave making boxes. True, Microsoft dominates operating systems and software and PCs, but it was a latecomer in mobile communications, which Nokia dominated. Besides, times change. In the past, Nokia and Microsoft were the toughest rivals. Today, they collaborate in a global alliance. More important, the Nokians had been building capabilities in operating systems and software already for half a decade. In the increasingly complex and global technology sector, no single company, not even a single nation, including the United States, which has ruled over the technology sector, can any longer dominate the entire ecosystem. Coming from a tiny country, Nokia had little arrogance. It took nothing for granted and had a humble view of globalization. Global integration is not a pretext to command and control markets, but a new foundation to sense and respond to markets. Still, this humility has often been misinterpreted as a sign of weakness. For example, consider this conversation, which took place only 2 years after the previous interview. This analyst represented a leading investment bank, which got into serious trouble during the global financial crisis. The high-end challenge was not Nokia's only concern. With the burst of the technology bubble and increasing outsourcing and offshoring in the early 2000s, many analysts, observers, and practitioners were absolutely convinced that low-end challengers would condemn Nokia to extinction. Nokia doesn't have a chance in hell. Why would you think that way? Today it is the underdog, but tomorrow it will be buried by new challengers in Asia. The argument was not entirely without basis. For example, in the 1990s, Chinese equipment manufacturers had no market share in China's nascent mobile marketplace. By 2003, their share had soared to 55%. But that was not the end of the story. Soon thereafter, foreign multinationals mounted their counterattack. After the dust settled, Nokia emerged as the winner not only in China, but also in India, the two most critical marketplaces of the 21st century, whereas many of its traditional Western rivals began a slow but sure decline. So why did the analyst I quoted misjudge Nokia? He took it for granted that because the company had initially built its manufacturing capabilities in high-cost Western Europe, the capacity would remain in Western Europe. In reality, Nokia began to move to China and India already in the mid-1990s. A decade later, Nokia could not be easily written off in the low-end marketplace because it enjoyed the kind of cost efficiencies that were as great as, if not greater than, those of the most competitive Chinese players. And overestimating Nokia's vulnerabilities. Still, Nokia's track record has in no way discouraged the prognosticators. Consider this exchange, which occurred in summer 2009. As you know, at this point in time, most investors consider Nokia a doomed company. But why would they think that way? The thinking is that Nokia will not be able to transform its business model and working practices to compete with Apple. iPhone will kill Nokia. This industry analyst represents still another leading investment bank, one that also got into trouble but is doing better after government subsidies. Here the notion is that Apple is the driver of the future in communications. The assumption is, again, that Nokia will happily go to its grave making boxes while superior rivals like iPhone will deliver the future. True, even if Nokia developed the first mobile multimedia devices, Apple was the first to come up with a highly attractive smartphone solution in the United States. Yet iPhone is not the only alternative in the marketplace. And as critical as America remains in the broad technology sector, it no longer dominates the ecosystem of mobile communications. The numbers may not tell the future, but they do illustrate the present. In 2008, the projected global market volume of mobile devices amounted to 1.2 billion units, whereas the sales of Apple's iPhone units soared to about 12 million. That means that in relative terms, iPhone's growth has been explosive. But in absolute terms, iPhone sales were less than 1% of the total. In stark contrast to iPhone sales of 12 million units, Nokia shipped 468 million mobile devices in 2008, including some 61 million converged devices, that is, mobile computers and smartphones. Clearly, Apple's success in the United States and in some other countries is impressive, but it's not enough. Winning across increasingly global markets requires just that. Winning across global markets. Conversely, Nokia must speed up its transformation to cope with rivals such as iPhone and BlackBerry in America and elsewhere, or it will risk its success in the future. After all, today one of the central challenges is to attract, grow, and retain developers for the new generation of mobile devices and solutions. It is not enough to have the capabilities to win the future. In order to truly benefit from the network effects, you must be perceived as the winner of the future. Since the 1990s, Nokia has served as a Rorschach test for many observers and analysts. The track record is that many tend to underestimate Nokia's strengths and overestimate its vulnerabilities. The question is, why? Nokia excels in quality and cost and innovation. For an entire generation, American managers have been taught to choose between quality or cost advantage. That is the very basis of the most popular theories of competitive advantage in strategic management. Yet Nokia has demonstrated that you can, and increasingly must, excel in both quality and cost efficiencies, while also excelling in innovation. A decade ago, Microsoft was seen as the future winner in mobile communications. Currently, iPhone carries that mantle. In both cases, the assumption is that the story of Nokia is over. Perhaps it could excel in quality, maybe it could thrive in cost efficiencies. But innovation is seen as Silicon Valley's birthright and as American as apple pie. In fact, perceptions have fallen behind realities. In an era of global integration, innovation is bound to be increasingly global and dispersed. In the past, what was good for GE may have been good for America. Today, what is good for Nokia may be good not just for America, but the world at large. And there is still more to the story. Both innovation and cost efficiencies are necessary, but achieving one without the other is insufficient for success in global markets. Today, companies must be able to sense and respond in all critical markets, in advanced economies, but especially in emerging markets. During the past two decades or so, the rise of the large emerging economies and the accompanying collapse of traditional cost structures across industries have dramatically accelerated the forces for cost efficiencies, quality, and innovation worldwide. But even more is needed for sustained global leadership. As Nokia has demonstrated, it is the combination of strategy, organization, and values that is vital in the dynamic, increasingly global, and rapidly changing environment. Throughout its recent history, Nokia has operated in an industry in which the forces for worldwide innovation are particularly intense. Since the 1990s, companies have been forced to seek high volume, that is, economies of scale through worldwide R&D, production, distribution, and marketing and sales, in order to amortize as quickly as possible the heavy investments they've had to make because of rising R&D expenditures, new technologies, and ever shorter product life cycles. Concurrently, the convergence of consumer preferences worldwide and the ever faster diffusion of technology have contributed to the acceleration of change and fragmentation of innovation. In the post-war era, American companies still enjoyed the most sophisticated business environment. In contrast, today, new consumer trends or market needs can emerge not only in New York, London, and Tokyo, or even Helsinki, Seoul, and Hong Kong. but also in Shanghai and Mumbai, Rio de Janeiro and Dubai. In the past, a U.S.-centered strategic mindset was the key to success. Even today, it remains necessary because America dominates the technology sector. Still, it is no longer sufficient. Today, a global mindset is a must. How to succeed without a large home market? Our situation is so difficult, if not hopeless, said a leading business journalist in Taipei. We have great engineers and electronics companies, but our population is barely 23 million, whereas even South Korea has more than 48 million. That's no home market. Nokia comes from Finland, whose population is about 5.3 million, and whose capital city, Helsinki, is located at 60 degrees north latitude, like Anchorage, Alaska, I replied. Size is a great asset when it is used strategically, but so is smallness when it comes with speed and flexibility. The story of Nokia is important across industries and heralds the future to many multinationals across the world. The reason is in its extraordinary positioning in terms of the competitive environment in the marketplace. Most major multinationals operate in a marketing-intensive or a technology-intensive environment. Unlike these companies, Nokia operates in a technology and marketing-intensive environment. Like Intel and Microsoft, it seeks to stay at the cutting edge of the latest technologies worldwide. Like Coca-Cola and Procter & Gamble, it also monitors closely the latest fashions and trends in the increasingly global markets. Nokia, however, is different from Intel, Microsoft, Coca-Cola, and Procter & Gamble in a crucial way. It was not born in a huge and prosperous home market. Today, Finland belongs to the prosperous elite of the world nations, but that legacy is fairly recent. Through much of their history, the Finns have struggled for survival, as witnessed by the national hymn. Our land is poor, it has no hold on those who lust for gain. Yet this poor land of ours would still our hearts with longing fill. Unlike large and wealthy nations, Finland, along with other Nordic countries, is dramatically dependent on international markets, foreign trade, and investment. As a result, and in contrast to most of its rivals, even Nokia's geographic distribution is much more even. Over a third of its net sales originate from Europe, and almost as many from Asia. The other sales come from the Americas, the Middle East, and Africa. Its home market, Finland, accounts for less than 1% of net sales. That makes Nokia, along with a few other multinationals, unique. When it comes to globalization, Nokia is in a category of its own. Unlike Coca-Cola, Procter & Gamble, Intel, and Microsoft, it is a multinational company that possesses virtually no home market of its own from a commercial standpoint. Despite the diversity of large country multinationals, most come from advanced economies, United States, Western Europe, Japan, or large emerging economies, especially the so-called BRIC economies, that is Brazil, Russia, India, and China. Because these multinationals originate from a great home base, their large home market is almost an inherited birthright. Due to its distinctive legacy as a small country multinational with a tiny home market, Nokia must be flexible and very responsive locally. On the one hand, because of its peculiar global strategy, it sees the world as a single global village, emphasizing uniformity in customer needs, distribution channels, offerings, markets, and regulatory requirements. On the other hand, its legacy as a small country multinational supports local responsiveness, pressuring the company to consider variations in customer needs, distribution, adaptations, market structure, and regulatory demands. This humility is a recipe for winning across global markets. To large country multinationals, foreign markets mean ancillary revenue sources. To small country multinationals, foreign markets are their revenue sources. Large country multinationals have most of their critical activities, from headquarters to R&D, in their home base. In contrast, small country multinationals have many of their critical activities dispersed worldwide. To the extent that globalization will continue and the future of the world is multipolar, globalization will be driven by multiple power centers worldwide. Nokia is the bellwether of multinationals in an increasingly multipolar world, and hence it is of interest to all of us and worthy of study. Necessity is the mother of invention, and it is the inherent constraints of Nokia's landscape, a minuscule home market and a highly technology-intensive, marketing-intensive environment, that have forced this company to develop the distinctive strategy, organization, and values that have led to its success. In turn, they may offer strategic inspiration for success to many other companies in various industries and environments. What this book reveals about Nokia. This book is not the first attempt to decipher the reasons for Nokia's success. However, it is the first independent effort based on free access to and dozens of interviews with all of Nokia's leading executives, including the CEO, chairman, board of directors, members of its famous group executive team, chiefs of functions, chiefs of key country markets, and former Nokians who have contributed critically to Nokia's success since the 1990s. It is also based on interviews with an extensive group of Nokia's managers, employees, rivals, partners, and suppliers, as well as public policy authorities and academic researchers in the Americas, Europe, Asia, Africa, and the Middle East. The underlying research and interviews have been carried out since 2004. Unlike its rivals, Nokia has had to struggle for much that most multinational companies take for granted. Indeed, it is the tremendous perseverance of the Nokians, both individually and in teams, that has motivated the company to win against all odds. Chapter 1 describes Nokia's success through legacy and globalization. Nokia has evolved through several eras and reincarnations, from a forestry company to a diversified conglomerate to a European technology concern to the globally focused mobile communications giant it is today. It is Nokia's ability to build on its legacy and take advantage of globalization that accounts for its success since the early 1990s. Chapter 2 focuses on Nokia's strategy and its executive team. Because Nokia is a small country multinational without a large home market and operates in a technology and marketing intensive environment, it is a global company that seeks to be externally oriented and internally collaborative, as Olli-Pekka Kalasvuo, Nokia's CEO, puts it. It is the executive team that serves as Nokia's collective mind. Chapter 3 takes a closer look at Nokia's values, culture, and people. Initially driven by Finnish perseverance, Nokia today is characterized by increasing diversity around the world. It is building a shared purpose through values. Indeed, Nokia's values are the glue that keeps the whole together while providing guidelines for global human resource management. Chapter 4 describes Nokia's unique structure, its globally networked matrix. In order to cope with rapid environmental change, Nokia's executives have paid special attention to building organizational capabilities for changing markets. The company has moved from an area structure to a worldwide product structure. It is the flat, team-driven, and networked organization that accounts for Nokia's agility and flexibility worldwide. Chapter 5 explores Nokia's global innovation via R&D networks. Innovation, understood broadly, is Nokia's most critical capability. This is reflected by the rapid expansion of the Nokia Research Center, which engages in long-term research. The company's unit-based R&D, which focuses on short-term development, and its globally networked university cooperation, open innovation, and venture funds. Chapter 6 describes Nokia's other strategic capabilities. Nokia's competitive strategies in mobile devices and services, solutions, and infrastructure rest on the foundation of its strategic capabilities. In addition to innovation, these include scale, demand and supply network, distribution, a powerful brand, and strategic marketing and global consumer insight. Nokia seeks to share its strategic capabilities among its business areas. Chapter 7 focuses on Nokia's business areas. Nokia is the world's number one manufacturer of mobile devices by market share and a leader in the converging internet and communications industries. It comprises devices, services, solutions, and markets augmented by infrastructure, Nokia Siemens Networks. This chapter illustrates Nokia's transformation in the converging mobile and internet arena and its transition toward solutions. Chapter 8 describes Nokia's global markets, particularly its success in large emerging economies. Nokia's mission, connecting people, is not intended to include some people some of the time, but all people all of the time. Until recently, advanced economies, the United States, Western Europe, and Japan, drove global growth. Today, it is the large emerging economies, particularly China and India, that are driving growth worldwide. Nokia is taking advantage of this change while accelerating and contributing to the growth of developing economies. Finally, Chapter 9 explores how Nokia seeks to maintain the drivers of its strategic advantages. The chapter focuses on the sustainability of Nokia's leadership. In the past, most accounts of Nokia's success have concentrated on a single driver of success. At best, these efforts highlighted one or another aspect of Nokia's success, but not the layers and sources of Nokia's strategic advantages and capabilities. This chapter also takes a look at different scenarios for the future and the preconditions of success in the world of mobile computers and smartphones. Today, Nokia accounts for 25% of the Helsinki Stock Exchange's capitalization and one-third of the national R&D spending. In the early 1990s, technologists despaired to find any job at Nokia, which led Finland out of a severe recession and contributed to the tiny country's dramatic growth. In the beginning of 2010, Finnish technologists were striking for better contracts, even as Finland's economy shrank by 7.6%, its worst performance in over 50 years. The future looked bleak. To many Finns, even bleaker than in the early 1990s. Few things are assured in Nokia's fast-changing world. What is certain, however, is that the lessons to be gained from this small country multinational will be studied for years to come because they herald the future of all multinationals in increasingly global markets that are technology-intensive or marketing-intensive, or both. Nokia's story is relevant to multinationals originating from large countries and small countries, and to those evolving in advanced economies and emerging economies. In this way, Nokia is the bellwether of the future. To see how, let's begin by looking at how Nokia grew from a forestry-based business in 1865 to the technological and marketing powerhouse it is today. 1. Success through legacy and globalization. In the late 1990s, Nokia's success seemed to come out of the blue in the worldwide markets. In reality, the company is a decade or two older than many leading multinationals, including General Electric, founded in 1876, and Coca-Cola, 1886, and almost a century older than such technology giants as Intel, 1968, and Microsoft, 1975. Nokia's legacy has evolved through several eras and reincarnations, from a forestry company to a diversified conglomerate to a European technology concern, and ultimately to the globally focused mobile and internet giant it is today. It is Nokia's ability to embrace change and adapt to the future that accounts for its global success since the early 1990s. But Nokia's organization is shaped by its past as well as by the external environment. Like other multinational companies, it has been influenced by the path by which it has evolved, its organizational history. This chapter takes a closer look at the company's fascinating history and evolution, particularly the key forces, legacy, and globalization that have enabled it to embrace change and contributed to its enormous growth and success. Origins of Nokia. Since Nokia's history is so embedded in Finland, a small Nordic country, some historical context is vital to understanding the company's growth and transformations. A forestry foundation. From the late 19th century to the 20th century, forestry was the industrial backbone of Finland's economy. In this era, most Finnish firms competed primarily on the basis of price in forestry-based or forestry-related industries that required little technology. At the same time, the Finnish economy remained sensitive to world economic cycles and exchange rates. Nokia grew along with the national ambitions of the small country that had been ruled for centuries by neighboring Sweden and Russia. Following the Crimean War, 1853 through 1856, Finland was joined to Russia and made an autonomous state, a Grand Duchy. The creation of Nokia as a small forestry enterprise coincided with a tremendous boom in the Finnish lumber industry, which put the country on the road to industrialization. But Finland was still a part of Russia. Fredrik Idestam, Nokia's founder, came of age in this era of optimism, entrepreneurialism, and new technological opportunities. Born in 1838 to a religious and educated family, the young engineer graduated from Helsinki University in 1863 and traveled to Germany, where Wilhelm Ludwig Luders had created a new and innovative process to manufacture pulp. In Magdesprung, Idestam visited the famous factory, only to be thrown out by Luders for what the German deemed industrial espionage. But Idestam had seen enough. In May 1865, he received authorization to build his mill in Nokia, a small town about 10 miles to the west of Tampere, Finland's then industrial center. Over time, the Nokia factory attracted a large workforce, and the town grew around it. That became the name and the foundation for the future Nokia Corporation, which is now located in Espoo, a garden city just a 15-minute drive from the center of Helsinki, and close to the famed university and technology center. While studying in Helsinki, Fredrik Idestam had met Leo Michelin, who later became Finland's first parliamentarian and played a crucial role in the struggle for independence. Nokia's two founding fathers, Idestam the businessman and Michelin the politician, were among the leading young Turks of a new Finnish generation. Their vision was an innovative company and an independent economy deeply intertwined with the world economy. Finnish forestry leaders leveraged their dominance at home into foreign markets. In contrast, Nokia built its foothold first in foreign markets, which allowed it later to build a position in the domestic market. As a result, it developed a more international mindset. Diversification into electrical power and other industries. In 1917, when Russia was swept by the turmoil of the Bolshevik Revolution, the Finnish Parliament approved the Declaration of Independence. After Lenin's Bolsheviks recognized the independence of their small neighbor, the Finns drifted into a bitter and devastating civil war between the nationalists and the socialists. These tumultuous years crushed many Finnish companies. Due to its increasing diversification and internationalization, Nokia was not as vulnerable as most forestry firms. By the 1920s, its paper and pulp mill, the Finnish Cable Works and the Finnish Rubber Works, sought leadership in their respective industries. Meanwhile, Nokia's corporate name became the joint foundation of all three companies. Indeed, it was only in 1966 that Nokia AB, Finnish Rubber Works, and Finnish Cable Works were formally merged to create Nokia Corporation. However, Nokia had already been listed in 1915. As Nokia transitioned from a family business to a public company, much of the correspondence was conducted in German, the business language of the era. Products were exported first to Russia and then to Great Britain and France. In the 1930s, China also became an important trading partner. During the Second World War, Finland fought against the Soviet Union and eventually Nazi Germany. Unlike the tiny Baltic states, Finland managed to retain its independence, but with a heavy price. After the devastation, 86,000 dead, 57,000 permanently disabled, 24,000 war widows, 50,000 orphans, 400,000 refugees from the ceded Karelia in the east, and 100,000 from Lapland in the north, 70,000 children evacuated, and the loss of eastern territories, nothing would remain the same, not even at Nokia. The devastation reinforced the Finns' legendary perseverance, but Nokia's vision had to change. It had to adapt to a new and very different future. The rise of the industrial conglomerate. After the peace treaty of Paris in 1948, Finland assumed a policy of neutrality and non-alignment, dictated by its geopolitical location next to the mighty Soviet Union. Over time, the new realpolitik became known as the Paasikivi-Kekkonen line, after the two prominent post-war presidents, Juho K. Paasikivi, who governed from 1946 to 1956, and Urho K. Kekkonen from 1956 to 1981. For decades, every Finnish schoolchild would learn President Paasikivi's words, "Acknowledging the facts is the beginning of wisdom." The subtle maxim highlighted the constraints of the small country in the geopolitics between the West and the East. The new era began in 1948 when the Finns signed the Treaty of Friendship, Cooperation, and Mutual Assistance with the Soviet Union, while agreeing to pay the estimated $300 million war reparations to the Soviet Union. Although Finland preserved its independence, it grew insulated internationally. Fortunately, Nokia thrived in spite and because of the country's overall insularity. As Moscow's court supplier, Nokia's cable business became the cash cow of the three-firm concern, that is, cable, rubber, and paper and pulp. Technology transfer was a different story because technology partnerships were seen as political alliances and thus eyed with suspicion at the Kremlin. Opening Finland to Western markets. Starting in the late 1950s, Finland opened its economy to Western Europe, that is, the European Economic Community, EEC, and the European Free Trade Association, EFTA. Whereas the Marshall Plan contributed to Germany's post-war economic miracle and the Korean War set the stage for the rejuvenation of the Japanese economy, the Finns missed both the Marshall Plan and the Organization for European Economic Cooperation, later OECD, due to Soviet opposition. As the foundations for bilateral Finno-Soviet trade were laid down, a substantial proportion of the Finnish economy adjusted to Moscow's command economy. Because of the delicate politico-economic balancing act with the Soviet Union, the first science and technology agreements with the United States were not signed until the late 1980s. After the years of reparations and reconstruction, Finland's President Kekkonen called for an extraordinarily high national savings rate and rapid accumulation of capital to speed up industrialization. After 1960, Finnish commercial ties with the Soviet Union and the other members of the Council for Mutual Economic Assistance, KOMKAN, also deepened. Concurrently, Nokia's business with Moscow was thriving. Björn Westerlund had been in charge of its cable business since 1956. As Nokia's CEO, he grew skeptical of Nokia's ability to sustain growth based solely on these markets. When Soviet revenues amounted to 20% of Nokia's total cable business, Westerlund warned the senior management, "We must be cautious and not allow the proportion of Soviet business to grow too much. If one day they'll say niet in Kremlin, we'll lose our business overnight." When Westerlund left his job in 1977, half of Nokia's exports were to the Soviet Union and half to the West. His successor retained this balance, thus saving the company from a catastrophe when the Soviet Union collapsed. At the time, only 10% of Nokia's total revenues came across Finland's eastern border. Diversification into electronics. Primarily between 1945 and 1980, Nokia consolidated several critical state-controlled and privately owned units of Finnish electronics, radio phones, and TV. It was not a purposeful strategy, but a complicated series of piecemeal moves in an effort to invest in innovation and growth. Televa. Starting in 1945, the State Electric Works, which had been launched in 1925 as a research laboratory of the Finnish Defense Forces, served as an industry catalyst. In 1981, Televa Oy was taken over by Nokia. This purchase was the final step in Nokia's consolidation of the nascent electronic and mobile communications industries in Finland. Mobira. In the early 1960s, Solora Oy, a veteran radio and TV set producer, diversified into radio phone manufacturing. Nokia's marketing activities with Solora resulted in increasing cooperation, which led to a joint venture, Mobira Oy, as in mobile radio, in 1979. Nokia's electronics. In 1960, the Finnish cable works diversified into electronics. Concurrently, Nokia began importing computer systems by Elliott in the United Kingdom and Siemens in Germany. The revenue base was tiny. To survive, Nokia had to internationalize. Nokia's consolidation of these various different firms was really a sum of a great many chances. At the same time, Nordic cooperation contributed to the expansion of nascent mobile communications. In 1967, the corporation took its current form as the Nokia Corporation. The new industrial conglomerate operated in forestry, rubber, and cable, and it was entering electronics. As Finn saw it, the name of the new company, Oy Nokia AB, came from wood processing, the management from the cable factory, and the money from the rubber industry. Yet in only a quarter of a century, all of these segments would be divested. It was the most insignificant business of all, electronics, that would position Nokia for the future. This meant a U-turn for a company that in the 1960s was still best known for its rubber boots, winter tires, and toilet paper. At the same time, the parliamentary elections of 1966 marked a major turning point in Finnish politics. The socialist parties gained their first absolute majority in half a century. With a series of center-left governments until the late 1980s, more than 80% of Finland's total workforce was organized into unions. Motivated by the fear of American multinationals and faith in socialist planning, a generation of new radicals began to promote the idea of a state-owned electronics giant, Valco. While Silicon Valley was emerging as the entrepreneurial hotbed in California, the Finns were moving in a diametrically opposite direction. Still, the plan, which required the socialization of Nokia, was in trouble from the beginning. It was driven by political posturing, not market opportunities. As the notion of a high-tech national champion failed, Nokia took over the ruins of Valco as well. Expansion into a European technology concern. In 1977, Kari H. Kairamo took charge of Nokia. Soon, change and flexibility became the new catchwords. Born into a wealthy family, Kairamo was energetic, charismatic, hardworking, persistent, independent, entrepreneurial, innovative, and rebellious. For all practical purposes, he was Nokia through the 1980s. He renewed and internationalized Nokia's vision. In the early 1970s, exports and foreign activities accounted for only 20% of total sales. By 1980, their proportion increased to more than 50% of total sales, while revenues quadrupled. Kari Kairamo was an extraordinary visionary, energetic and energizing, but he could be challenging to the organization, described Sauri Baldoff, one of Nokia's leading executives in the 1990s boom era. At times, we had to cope with substantial uncertainty. Still, Kairamo's era meant bold risk-taking and a clear long-term perspective. Kari was very committed to the devices, joint ventures, and telecom technologies overall. Growth through bold mergers and acquisitions. By the mid-1980s, Nokia had been transformed from a diversified industrial conglomerate into an electronics concern. CEO Kairamo's prime objective was to transform Nokia into a European technology concern. European industry, as well as the cost structure of products, has become increasingly knowledge-based, he said. To us, internationalization is not an alternative to something else. Finland has only two resources, the people and the trees. In the past, Finland had been about natural resources and comparative advantage. In the future, it would have to be about human capital and competitive advantage. Export success, however, was predicated on Nokia's sustained ability to internationalize. That is the greatest risk facing the Finns, Kairomo stated, the small amount of international business experience. If the Finns did not yet know much about the world certainly knew little about the Finns. Wherever you went during those days, recalls Baldauf, you always had to spell the name of Nokia. N-O-K-I-A, Nokia, not Nokia, not Japanese. We were not internationally relevant yet, except for certain limited market areas. At the time, Nokia had few alternatives. Western countries were still dominated by national telecom monopolies. The only opportunities were in Asia and Northern Africa. There was no global strategy yet, says Matti Alahuhta, who later became Nokia's executive vice president and president of the infrastructure and mobile device businesses, respectively. To compete with the European national champions, Kairomo began a frantic wave of merger and acquisitions, M&A activities, and despite doubts, Nokia also pushed into consumer electronics in the 1980s. After Solora, the largest Finnish TV producer, it acquired Luxor AB, Sweden's faltering state-owned electronics and computer concern, which was followed by the purchase of Oceanic. In 1988, Nokia also created the largest IT group in Scandinavia, Nokia Data, by purchasing Ericsson Group's data division. By the late 1980s, Nokia was Europe's third-largest player in TV manufacturing, its market value had tripled, and it was the largest company in Finland. A balancing act between Western and Eastern markets. At the same time, the company faced a delicate balancing act vis-à-vis the Soviet Union. Nokia's Soviet trade still amounted to 39% of the total in the early 1980s, but investments were moving into technology, and that meant the West. Kairomo could not easily distance Nokia from Moscow, nor could he approach Washington. During the 1960s and 1970s, Finlandization became a cautionary catchword in the West. In the Soviet embassy, every major Finnish politician of significant standing had a close friend in the KGB with whom they kept in touch, a kotirisa, or a home Russian as the Finns put it. Nokia's CEO was no exception. Viktor Vladimirov, a KGB general, deemed Kairomo one of the most important Finnish industrialists with whom he kept in regular contact. After the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan in 1980, the Reagan administration boycotted the Moscow Olympics and prohibited technology exports to the Soviet Union. At the time, Finland, spearheaded by Nokia, served as one of Moscow's key suppliers of Western technology. NATO suspected that the Finns were leaking technology to the East. The future of Finnish electronics depended on Silicon Valley and close contact with the U.S. technology sector. So Kairomo had to convince Washington and its allies that critical technology products were not being given to the Kremlin. That began Kairomo's quest for a third way, that is, European integration. And this was a decade or two before it became ideologically faddish and politically safe in Finland. In 1987, when the conservatives returned to the government after a quarter of a century, Kairomo led the talks of the non-socialist parties. And in the spring of 1987, he triggered a national debate by insisting that Finland should join the European Council. Kairomo was no longer part of the old red capitalist guard, the corporate elite closely connected.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.